stand still. I'm like a giant wind that's crashing. Oh yeah. The sand is shaking, quaking. No time to chill. Gotta put it all together in a place I call Forever Summer. Oh yeah. What an awesome atmosphere.
Forever Summer.
A little kiss on the pier.
Forever Summer.
Whoa. Dreams are served up by the slice.
Forever Summer.
A little piece of paradise. Oh yeah.
Whoa. Forever Summer.
Oh, Forever Summer.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe. Attack ships on fire off the ship of Orion. I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Tannhauser Gate. I've also seen this movie called Bad Ronald like 15 times. It was dope.
Entertainment Landfill. Film, television, pop culture. It's where you find it.
Welcome to another exciting episode of Entertainment Landfill News. I am your host, the J-Strom, and I'm here to talk about film, television, and pop culture news type stuff. And I don't do the show alone. I do it with Steven, the pop culture zealot.
Hey, what's happening?
Hello, Steven. How's it going?
It's going great.
It's so good to hear from you today.
I know. It's good to hear from you. Good seeing you too, my friend.
How are you doing, sir?
It's great.
Have you been doing well?
Very well, sir.
Nice. You know, I saw that. Do you want to tell anybody about a new purchase you made? Or?
Oh, my new hot rod. Yes, I bought a new car. The last time we did a show.
Whoa, that's the sound of it right there. Pretty sweet.
The last show we did on my way home.
Yes.
The old Xterra. Blew a timing belt.
Ooh.
And I was stuck on the side of the road for an hour, at least.
That sucked. Because I remember you...
And I kept hearing horror stories from other people telling me, oh, the timing... One of my coworkers said he had an Xterra. He said, with the timing belt, it just fried the engine. So I was just like, I guess I got to go buy a new car. I didn't even think to go... You know, it's like, it's just ruined. I know
it
is.
Well, it was funny, you texted me that night, like, you know, as soon as the show was over, you and I, like, talked for, like, a long time after the show, and then you left, and I went and got dinner or something, a late dinner, and when I came back, you said,
my car broke down.
Dead. And I was like, where are you? And you were like, I'm on the highway about a mile from my house or
about
something like that.
About half a mile from and the exit, yeah.
Yeah, I was like, do I need to come and get you? And you were like, no, my brother's coming. And I was like, holy shit, that sucks. You know, because
I just like letting people know where I'm at in case.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, cause I know I'm horrible, waiting on my brother.
The bad thing about it is that you fly on an airplane Friday, land in Texas, come over, do a show, and then break down on the way home. It's just like, I'm tired. You know, I bet you're exhausted. Yeah.
Now I gotta get up early, go look for cars. Which I've been looking for about 2 or 3 years looking at cars, and thankfully my job, I rent cars weekly, so I try different cars.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've been debating between two. The new Camaro, a newish Camaro, not brand new, because my car's not brand new that I bought either. And the Challenger.
Yeah, Dodge Challenger.
Both kind of sporty cars. And I was like,
And I was a little surprised by that because you've driven an Xterra for so long. I figured you were more into like a SUV type of vehicle.
Well, I bought that for work's sake.
Mm-hmm.
I had a pickup truck before that, and mm-hmm. we kept having to haul equipment.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think of the car you had before that. What did it look
like? The Nissan Frontier pickup.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Wasn't it red?
Black.
Black. Why am I not remembering this?
I had the red one when we worked together. I had a red Chevy pickup at MJ's.
Okay.
That was a long time ago.
I remember even longer.
Oh, I had the Toyota red one, too.
Okay, yeah. That's what I'm thinking of.
That's the one when you lived over those apartments it got broke into.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I remember even longer. Did you not have a... shit, I'm blanking.
I've had lots of cars,
sir. What is the car that... An El Camino.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I remember when you had an El Camino. I remember every once in a while some guy would like, we would be like going to Subway and walking out, getting in the car, and the guy would go, hey man, how much? How much you sell this for? And I'd be like, why do people want to buy this? But there's like people who love El Caminos
yes,
out there.
Yes, there's a market for those things.
Yeah, so like, how much for your El Camino?
It's not for sale because it's paid for. I don't have a payment.
Yeah. So you buy a Dodge Challenger.
So,
it doesn't sound like a challenge.
So I want either an SS Camaro or the RT
right.
Challenger.
And sweet.
And price comparison wise, the SS is about 10,000 more. I'm going to cut my losses on that, and I'm going with the Challenger.
We had just recently gone through that because we got a new Equinox, and you know. I wanted to go up one tier from what we had before. Like, I'd like to have the screen navigation in that.
Yeah.
But then they're like, hey, let's show you this model, the even more expensive model. And you're like, well, this would be nice, but no, let's go back down.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm calculating the payments in my head and going, okay. Not that I couldn't afford the more expensive car, but, you know, it's just like... Just rein it down. Don't go crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't, you know.
You want to treat yourself, but not go crazy.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
Yeah. I don't want to be just totally indebted for a car.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, technically, really, that car cost as much as my Xterra mm-hmm. did when it was brand new. I bought that one brand new off the lot.
When you broke down on the side of the freeway, did you immediately say, that's it, I'm getting a new car? Was it like that? Like, have you had a lot of problems with your Xterra over the years?
No, I haven't had a lot. I've taken really good care of it. Mm-hmm. But like I said...
Yeah, I figured so.
I mean, hell, it's 14, 15 years old.
I'm trying to think of what... On our Equinox, what was it, the catalytic converter or something? But anyway, they were like, it costs $5,000 to fix. I'm like, we're trading it in. I'm not paying that, you know.
Screw you. If you went to a muffler shop, it wouldn't have cost that much.
Yeah, it's like, we're not paying for that. You know, I remember the worst breakdown I ever had was when we first got this house and we hadn't moved in yet. And we were coming over at night. We were still in our apartment in Fort Worth. And we'd drive over here, like I would work and come over and we'd paint the walls or whatever.
Because I was coming over and helping paint too, mm-hmm. a little bit.
From time to time, yeah. And so we had like basically till the end of the month, we needed to be out of the apartment. Mm-hmm. So we were like trying to get things in order here. And I had that Celica Supra, the 85 mm-hmm. Celica Supra, and it had an oil leak. And I knew that I could either... You know, go buy a quart of oil, pour it in there, or I think it's going to be okay. I don't think all the oil is leaked out of there or anything like that. So on the way home on 287, I heard that, and I was like, oh, God, this isn't good. This isn't good. And I was like, mayday, mayday. And it was like, and it, like that. Engine seized up. I knew I'd like crack the engine block or whatever. There's no oil in the car. And I was just like coasting and I was pulling over the side of freeway. And I was like, it was like going down and in a ship. Like I was like, mayday, mayday. You know, this is back in the time where no cell phones. I didn't have a cell phone. Heather didn't have a cell phone.
Cell phone. I was going to ask you.
And it was 287 in the middle of nowhere on that. And I got out of the car and I'm not kidding. Pitch blackness. There were no street lights or whatever. And I was walking in pitch blackness on the freeway. All I could see was when headlights would come by with cars. And I was walking for a while, and I could hear dogs barking, and I was like, God, I hope those dogs were behind a fence or something, because it was so scary.
I'm about to be mauled by wild dogs.
And I remember finally walking onto the street right there. I don't remember what it was, Lancaster or something out there. I don't know. But, and there was like a liquor store, and there was like all sorts of like kind of, you know, sketchy denizens.
Was that adult bookstore there? Was that there?
I'm trying to think of what street that is.
The log cabin, the Kennedale.
Oh, no, no. It wasn't. It was further down 287, like in, the Pauley area.
Yeah.
And so I was walking towards this liquor store, and I'm like, I'm going to have to go in this sketchy-ass, shady place.
Yeah.
I don't even want to walk by these people. I'm scared. And I swear, just right then, a cab in the parking lot as I was walking drove up, and I go, hey, can I get a ride? And the guy was like, sure, man, hop in. I was like, oh, thank Christ. And I told him, you know, my address, and I was driving there, and I was like, I don't have any cash on me. And I was like, you take credit cards, right? And he's like, yep. And I was like, thank God. And I remember walking up the stairs, like, knowing my car was dead. Like, I was screwed. My car wasn't broken down. It was dead. Like, it was gone. And there had been a death in the family. And I was walking up the stairs, and I remember I could see Heather through the window. She was in the kitchen wrapping plates and glasses in newspaper and putting them in a box. And I remember just standing there, like, looking at her through the window, and I'm like, I go, guess what? What? Where have you been? And I was like, I was walking down 287. And it was like, what? And I was like, my car's toast. And I remember I had to have it towed, and I didn't know what to do with it. And it was kind of a really dumb decision I made, which was to replace the engine.
Yeah.
So it was like $3,000 to replace the engine, and I had that done. And I did it mainly because I love the car so much. Mm. What I should have done is use that $3,000 and just put
down
money
payment on a car.
Put down payment on a new car. That's what I should have done. But back then, you know, don't have a time machine.
Young and dumb.
Young and dumb, make poor decisions. And I mean, I had a car running again within a couple of weeks, but still, probably should have bought a new car. Because remember, not long after that, we sold that car to Heather's cousin. No, it was a while. It sat in my driveway for a while, too. But, yeah, so you decided, I'm going to just get a new car.
Yeah, my brother came that night, and I said, you got a tow strap. I don't want to leave it on the freeway. My truck is black. It's just on the other side of an overpass. Somebody swerves a little bit out, just a little bit. And I wasn't sure about anybody wrecking into the car. I didn't want anybody to get hurt.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, that's fine. If the truck gets wrecked, it gets wrecked. But, you know, I don't want to be responsible for somebody just kind of swerving and hitting that. So I felt a little bad, you know. I would feel bad.
Very understandable. Was it easy to tow?
Yeah, it wasn't too bad. My brother Mike's towed me lots of times. Yeah,
he's pretty handy.
Because I've had old beaters, you know, all my life, you know.
I have a memory.
But it's been a long time since. So it's like, you're trying to relearn how to do that. Because it's like, I haven't been towed with a tow strap in 20 years.
I've had
decent cars for more than 20.
I have this vague memory of you and I being stranded before. In your car. It might have been the El Camino or one of those cars.
The El Camino never got stranded, I'll tell you that.
Maybe it was that Mazda or something.
The RX-7, maybe?
It was something. And I remember you calling Mike, and you and I were just kind of, we gone to Blockbuster, and we were about to get food, and we were just kind of stranded. And I've never seen you mad before, but I remember you just kind of like punching the steering wheel. And you're like, let me go call my brother. Again, before cell phones, you had to go inside. So he came out there, and I remember him, like, just lifted. He did something, and the car started, and you were like, well, didn't you try that, Steven? And you were like, shut up, or something like that. We were like, come on, and we, like, just drove over to my house or whatever. But I vaguely have that memory or something. Yeah. It happens.
But, yeah, I've had, you know, so this time he pulled it up and just parked it right in front. And
you know, most
so I call him up the next morning, and it's like, hey, I found a car online I want to go look at. Will you? And he came over, picked me up, and took me to the lot. And I was pretty sure I was going to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was the right price. It had low miles, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay. I went and looked at it, test drove it. I was like, all right, I like this. And it was a... Well, it's 4 years old, so it didn't have the new little weird check pattern on the seat. Everything's really dark and black and dark gray on the inside. It's like, okay, and the window, I don't have to mess with tint. It's great.
You know what's funny is, you know, you see on TV shows or whatever when you go buy a car, you know, it's just like, hey, I'll handle this. I'll talk to the guy. And you're supposed to, like, look around a little bit, but...
Yeah.
When I told Heather, I was like, we need to just trade in our Equinox and get a new one. You know, I knew I liked the Equinox and I wanted to just get another Equinox 2019 or whatever. And I was like looking online. I go, here, this is one we should go for. And we'd had a black one for a while, but I was like, let's get a gray.
Mm-hmm.
And when we went on the lot, the guy was like, hey, what do you want to, what are you guys interested in? And I go, the 2019, Chevy Equinox, and I went in a gray, and he was like, oh, okay. And he was like, took us over, and he goes, what do you think of this? And I was like, forget that, what is that color? And it was midnight gray and kind of these little specklies on it, and I was like, that's the one I want. And he was like, oh, okay. And he's like, you sure you don't want to look at some other stuff? And I was like, let's look at a few other things. And then we went back to it, but it was just like, I kind of felt like I guess I just knew what I wanted exactly, and Heather
was kind of that way too.
Wanted that too. There was one white one that was kind of nice, and we were kind of like, no, we don't want white.
So I went last Saturday. My plates finally came in. You know, it's hard for me to get over there traveling.
Mm-hmm,
so I go up there Saturday to pick them up. And
any thoughts on a custom license plate at all?
No.
Vroom or something.
So I go inside, and the guy who did the dress drive with me, I was like, hey, I'm here to pick up my plates. And it took him a second. He goes, oh, Challenger guy. He goes, how you liking it? He goes, guess what? We got the big dog on lot now, the big Challenger, the
decked out RT one.
No, not the RT, the Hellcat.
Oh, the Hellcat, yeah.
The 800 horsepower goes.
800 horsepower.
You ready to trade it in and get the Hellcat? I'm like, no.
Wow, 800 horsepower.
I don't need an $80,000 car.
Yeah. It's like, going once, going to. Okay, you're not interested.
I was like, no, I'm fine. Let me get the license plate and get the hell out of here. Let me put the blinders on and walk, you know.
That's funny.
So, but I didn't even see it. You know, he goes, it just came in.
You know what's
like
funny?
The day
is,
before, so I guess they hadn't even cleaned it up and brought it out. He was ready just to show me.
Would
right?
you call it a midlife crisis car?
No, because I mean,
has anyone called it that?
Yeah,
like
yeah,
said,
yeah.
Oh, Steve, midlife crisis.
Yeah.
See what you got, little hot rod. But I would totally. I mean,
when I was young, I couldn't afford.
Yeah.
The insurance or
treat
the car.
Yourself. You know, it's funny for years, you know, now, because we live in the same school district, that I saw this Dodge Challenger waiting outside of schools with me. You know, I'm sitting in the car, and it said Dr. Doom on the license plate. It's like this black Challenger, just like yours, but it had some racing stripes. And I would look in there, the guy, he's like, I'm Dr. Doom or whatever. And I always laugh at that because I would see it like every day.
If I did the personal plates and it was something kooky or whatever, you know, then yeah, I would say midlife crisis. If I did,
Here's the funny thing though. Recently, I saw Dr. Doom again, but it wasn't on a Challenger anymore. It was like on this little hatchback. And
so he couldn't afford the Challenger anymore.
He traded in, I guess, for a family vehicle or something. And I was like, can you do that? Can you take your license plate with you on another car, apparently?
You're paying for the private plate, yeah.
Oh, okay. So, but
I mean, you have to go get it re-registered.
And I remember just seeing, hey, there's the Dr. Doom guy. Oh, step down. Like, ah. It's like, you know.
The Honda CRX hatchback. Yeah, ouch.
Like, ooh, that's painful. Dr. Doom wouldn't be caught dead in that car.
That's Mrs. Doom's car.
But that was, yeah, that's Mrs. Doom's. And I remember just seeing that and going, just feeling bad for the guy. Like, ah, feels bad.
I said, what did you have? One or two more kids? Yeah. To get a.
Because, I mean, like.
Because you're not getting in the back seat of my car.
Yeah,
we,
yeah.
We discussed this last night when we were chatting.
Yeah.
And it was just like.
It's not a practical family vehicle.
You're like, so can I get in the back seat? I said, no.
You're not getting back there. Getting,
you would have to turn. You would have to sit sideways with your legs splayed out over the other seat.
Steven, I'm miserable back here.
Yes, you would. I mean, you would really have to be about 4 years old to sit in the back.
Yeah, so that's probably what happened.
Plus, it's difficult to get in and out of the back seat.
That's what happened. His child got larger and couldn't ride in the car anymore.
It's like, yeah, after fighting, getting in and out of that back seat, it's like, I'm done fighting that.
Is there a huge trunk space in the back?
The trunk's pretty good. You could probably get into the back seat easier through the trunk than through the side door.
Just get in the trunk.
Just get in the trunk. It's huge.
Nice. Well, congratulations, Steven. That's a pretty badass vehicle you got there.
And I really didn't want to drive it to the airport, but since I didn't have another car. But
have you decided what you're going to do with the Xterra?
No, I got it fixed. I think I told you. Right? What?
Could you hear your Xterra when you drive up in the Challenger? It goes, oh.
So sad. My brother Mike was saying his fiance's son is in need of a vehicle. So I haven't decided just yet, but anyway, so that's on my, you know, it's in the back burner. It's like, okay, maybe.
Could you always trade it into the dealership, or can you not do that after you've already bought the car?
No, I don't think. No, because I've already done all the paperwork on the car.
So. Yeah.
So, I mean, I could outright sell it. I was kind of worried after, you know, a 15-year-old car. I looked at the blue book. I was like, okay, it's only worth $3,000.
Yeah.
You know, it's not worth anything.
That's a funny thing.
The
and
car lot's going to give me $500 for it.
When you're on, when you're buying the car, you know, the guy was like, I don't think we have to tell you. Once you drive it off the lot, it lowers this percentage in value. And I'm like, really? Jesus. Like, just driving it off the lot, the value of the car goes down. It's just all downhill from there, you know?
It's like, well, I bought the gap insurance, too. So if something happens wreck-wise, it's covered. Yeah.
Well, that's one thing, because with our Equinox, when we've had it for years, it was a 2013. You know, you can eventually, your warranty will start to go out and they'll go, hey, for this much extra, extend that warranty. And I think we might have done it once, and then it was time to... I'll never do this again, by the way, but I was just like, kind of like, okay, yeah, we'll get to that. But then it just lapses. And that's what happened is, you know, like last time there was a thing and the guy was
like, we take care of it. We get the oil changed. Yeah. Nothing's bad.
I've taken it to the dealership the whole life of the car and it had the drivetrain. It has a drivetrain warranty. And the guy was like, yep, free of charge. You know, don't worry, we'll handle this. And I'm like, great. So then the next time there's a problem, I could hear, like, when I'm at a light, I could hear kind of like a grinding, like, kind of sound. I'm like, whoa, that doesn't sound good. Like, when I'm starting to slowly accelerate, you could hear kind of a, and does not sound good. I'm like, that's not good. I have a grave feeling about this. So I took the car in, and he was like, oh, yeah, your warranty's out. It's going to be about $5,000 or whatever. And I was just like, no, we're not paying that. And I remember the guy was just kind of looking at me like, what? You know, what do you mean you're not going to pay? It's like, because I'm just going to trade the car in, you know, not here, though, mind you. Because I already told you the guy kind of made really annoy me because I was waiting about 2 hours. And by the time he was like, yeah, we could get that done. You know, how much longer would I? If I said yes, I would be there all friggin' day, you know, at that point. And I was just really annoyed. And I remember coming home and I go, Heather, what do you think about us trading that in?
It seems weird to $5,000 for catalytic converters.
Mm-hmm. It was something else wrong with it. I just can't remember now. And when we went to get the new car, we got a really good deal and a really good payment. And then I was telling Heather, like, when we, you know, you go and talk to the guy about the warranties and all that, and he goes, and he offered us this really good warranty covery of everything, scratches on it, all this stuff, top tier, like anti-theft stuff, you know, and all this. And I was just like, and he was like, that'll be this much extra. And I was thinking about monthly car payment. I was like, what is the next step down from that one? You know? And I go, do you cover drivetrain warranty, catalytic converter, blah, 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 all that for this many years? And he goes, yep, all that's covered, whatever. It's like, we'll do that one. And then when it comes time for that to be up in 5 years or whatever, I'm going to get the extended warranty and keep going. Because I never want to go through that again where I'm waiting in a car waiting room and the guy comes
in. You drop
it
off and they give you a rental car.
Yeah, I'm never going to be this way where I the guy comes in and he goes, yeah, this is going to cost you $5,000. And I'm like, oh, hell no, it's not going to happen. So I was like, I never want to be in this position again. I want to be covered by all the warranty stuff, which is crazy because when you think about it, if nothing goes wrong with the car for a long time, you're just paying, what, for air?
Yeah. So I'd been wanting to I'd been looking at before this was if I got this type of car, I was wanting like what I call an airport car, one that gets good gas mileage. And, you know, and if it gets a door ding, okay, it's a, you know, little inexpensive Hyundai or whatever, you know, just something to take to the airport. But it's like, now is my Xterra that? Do I take it to the airport and leave the... I need to clear out the garage, pull the Challenger in on the weekdays, just take the Xterra.
It was funny, just the other night, Heather, I was already in bed.
The insurance is crazy. I got to, you know...
I didn't think about that.
I got a, you know, two car. I dropped that one down to liability, the Xterra. Which didn't drop it that much, like $100 over 6 months.
We didn't go up too much on our insurance, and I was like, Heather, is this is full coverage, right? Because this is a brand new car. And she goes, yeah. And I'm like, how is it this cheap?
It's cheaper because you got newer parts. My insurance kept going up. It's like, okay, now they got to go back and get. They don't make these parts for my 2004 Xterra anymore. They got to go to an off-site maker, you know, of parts.
What was funny the other night...
Your insurance kind of goes up a bit because now they're having to find aftermarket parts.
We're, like, extra careful. We want to protect this car from door dings or whatever. I'm always parking a little, you know, I don't want anyone to park next to me and stuff. I haven't done the crooked thing or anything, but...
I park next to... more expensive cars at the airport.
Well, the other night, Heather came into the room and she was like, it's going to hail tonight. I keep seeing that it might hail. Do you want to move the car in the garage? And she said that I like was just like. And so she goes out and she's backing up the Sonic in the driveway. And then she's opening up the garage and she's trying to maneuver the Equinox in the car. And if you step out of the car and you leave the keys in the car, it'll go to warn you. And that woke me up. And I go, what the hell that was? And with the garage door open right here to the garage, it's like loud as hell. And I like got up and I walked out there in a daze. Like, you ever like be woken up suddenly where you're like shaking?
Yeah.
Like, what the hell is going on? And I see her. She's like sitting in the garage in the car, like looking at me through the windshield. And she goes, what are you doing? Go back to bed. I wasn't. And I go, whoa, what's going on? And she goes, it's going to hail. I had to protect the car. Go back to bed. Go back to sleep. And I'm like, what? I don't understand what's going on, you know? And so she's like, closing the garage and she's driving the other car up. So I'm still standing there when she comes back in. She goes, why are you still standing here? And I'm like, I don't understand what's going on. She goes, it might hail. I was trying to get the car in the garage. And I was like, oh. And so it's like, I don't know, it's like 2 a.m. or something. And so I lay back in bed and she's like, go to sleep or whatever. And I'm just like, I'm up, dude. I am not sleepy. Like, it was the kind of jolt awake. It's like, shit, I'm not going to go to sleep for a long time. And I was just like laying in bed and I had my earbuds in to listen to stuff. I'm like, come on, dude, go to sleep. And I was like, I couldn't. I was wired after that. And guess what? It never hailed. Yeah. One of the funniest things ever is, I don't know if it was a year ago or a couple years before that, they were like, the largest hailstorm in history is coming. Hailmageddon. And I was like, oh, shit. Heather, what are we going to do? And this is before we cleaned out our garage. There was not going to be a car. So I drove up to the Parks Mall where they have the underground garage or the, what do they call it? The parking garage. I had Heather meet me up there. We parked the Sonic. I drove her home. I drove back up and sat in that parking garage with both cars waiting for the world, the largest hailstorm ever in the history of mankind. And not a single hail pellet fell that night. And Heather was like, yeah, I'm watching the weather and it's already passed by the storm. You can come home. And I'm like, how am I going to get both cars home? I was like thinking a minute, okay, I could drive this car home and then I could come back. Wait, how am I going to get back? No, wait. Okay. I'll drive the other car home. Then I get home and then, wait, no, wait, how do I get back up? Oh, wait. And it's like,
I got to go pick up Heather.
Yes. Up here. Wait, I know. I go home. Heather gets in the car with me, drive back. Then she gets, okay, that's how it happened. And it's just like,
there's, I didn't just think about driving up to the car wash right up here on the corner.
No, filled. I'm not kidding. Sonic, filled. The car wash is filled. Anything you could think of with a cover. I remember there was a nearby church, and I was like, I could pull up there. And I remember driving up to that, cars all parked under it. And I was like, damn it. People who
under
go to that church.
Bridges.
Yeah, yeah. Just insane. And there were people all, like, they were having, like, a nice bumper-to-bumper, you know, barbecue or something in there, all waiting for Hailmageddon. But it was funny. One of my thoughts was this. Drive a block, walk back, get the other car, drive a block, get the other car, drive a block.
Yeah. Easy leapfrog.
Okay. Okay. That would be fun. Just to document somebody doing that, just to see how long
that
it would take.
That would
take
you hours.
I know. It would be so much. I can see Steve Martin and the Jerk doing that, you know?
It'd be funnier if you just... You drove one car in front of the other, then parked, and just only 10 feet or so.
And I could just see someone standing there going, what the hell's that guy doing?
What kind of game of Frogger is this dude playing?
This is one stupid son of a bitch here. But yeah, just go pick up your wife and have her drive home. It's like, oh, okay, that works. Yeah. So whenever there's a hailstorm now, I'm just like, I don't know. You ever heard
during
the boy cried wolf?
During the week, I'm not concerned. Mine's parked in a parking garage at the airport.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like, I'm good during the week. I only have to worry about 2.5 days.
See, I would probably, you know, we have a brand new car. I would definitely do it now. This is before our car is brand new. And we were still trying to protect it.
Yeah.
Because I've seen, I remember Laura a long time ago, she was caught in a horrible hailstorm where it shattered.
Is that the one at Mayfest?
Her window. I don't know. I'm trying to think of, it was when I still worked at MJ Designs that happened. She was trapped on the freeway in this horrible hailstorm and it shattered her windshield, rear and front windshield. And that's the worst thing I've ever saw. That would be terrible to be in something like that.
There was one that went right through kind of downtown over by Trinity Park, you know, mm-hmm. where Mayfest is held.
Yeah.
And it went over that park, through that area and right through downtown. And an old high school friend of mine, we had one of those meetups at a bar and we were all chatting and it was right after that. She's like, oh yeah, I just bought a brand new car. It's parked downtown, totally destroyed.
Yeah.
Ruined, you know, in 5 minutes.
Yeah. I wonder like, the car's covered right now. If that something bad did happen to it. It would just be an annoying thing to deal with, I guess. Yeah. You wouldn't want to have to deal with it.
I don't want to have to look for... At least I have a second car right now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, some of you guys got two cars now.
Yeah, that's why the Sonic, I was like, that car is 2013, leave it in the driveway. We'll see what happens, you know.
And it's got next to no miles on it, right?
It's got about 68,000 miles on it.
Not too bad.
Yeah, not too bad. Oh, and when we do, the Equinox had like 74,000 miles. It nowhere near 100,000 miles. Like, we've driven it, you know, a lot, but not that much. You know, I'm mostly taking Emma to school, yeah. You know. We'll go on the, like, we drove to Fredericksburg, which was a four-hour drive, and then 4 hours back. And that's probably the most we'll put on it for a year, you know. It's the longest trip we'll be on. And I love, you know, like, you did the auto start. Like our Equinox has that during the winter when it's like 28 degrees in the morning. I love just looking out the window and starting it.
I can't wait for that warming. When it gets cold again to be able to do this.
And I'm like, and Emma and I get in the car and we're like, toast.
I'll probably be so tired not thinking of it, you know. Like, go out there, I could have started it and been warm.
I want to also, like, our old car used to always get super foggy and it would take forever, but on this one it has a setting, you just hit it, it just goes. And it, like, immediately, like, I'm like, oh, nice. Me like, oh, and this car has a rear AC vent in the back seat. Because in the summertime, our old car didn't. And Emma would be like, I'm so hot back here. And she'd have to sit right in the middle. And we'd kind of, like, try to get the vents aimed at her. But now this, there's a vent in the back seat that blows on her. That's perfect. It's really important to have especially in Texas.
My question to you, your Equinox you traded in, you had Sirius Satellite in it, right?
Yes.
And the car I just bought has it, and it's running still. I haven't paid for it.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's difficult as hell to cancel your subscription.
It's really not.
My brother, he canceled it every year for 4 years, and they kept recharging him. Even on a different credit card.
Our Sonic, because Heather started working from home. I was like, paying. Like,
some dude's paying for my.
Here's
I'm gonna keep. I'm gonna listen to it until they cut it off.
Well, here's what. Will you get a free? A lot of times you'll get a free trial for like 3 months or something.
This is a used car, 4 years old. They're not gonna give you a free trial on that.
Oh yeah, it's
if
possible.
If it was a brand new car, I would say it could be 3 to 6 months of.
What happened with our Sonic is I called and I said, we're not driving this car right now and we're paying for Sirius and I want to cancel it. And they're like, well, what if you start driving it again? And I'm like, well, I'm not for the foreseeable future. She goes, what if I just suspend the account and you can call and tell me when you're going to reactivate it? And I'm like, I really don't want to do that because we're not driving it around. She goes, how about 8 months from now, you can reactivate it if you want. And I'm like, okay, fine. And so what happens? Okay, so it's
suspended.
It's suspended for eight months. What happens? I forget about that.
They start charging.
All of a sudden, I get charged for a year for like $200-something because, you know, we have it where it charges for the year. And I'm like, what the hell is this charge? And I call, and I'm really pissed off. And I go, I really, because before, I'm just kind of chill and laid back, and I let them walk all over me. But this time, I call, and I'm pissed off, and I go, I didn't want to suspend this in the first place. I wanted to cancel it. Okay, the person talked me into suspending it. Now I'm being charged $200. I don't want that. I want my money back now, and I want to cancel it. She goes, sir, I'm so sorry. I see that your other vehicle has Sirius. Do you want to roll it over? I'm like, no, I don't. I don't want to roll it over where that $200, you don't give it back to me. I just pay for the other car.
Another year.
And I'm like, no, I want my money back. And she's like, okay. And she's like, and she gave me this really sweet deal. I want to apologize. So how about we're going to give you a year for free, and then we're going to charge you, and it was something like, you know, if you have all these channels or whatever. And I was like, I want to cut it way down. I just want, like, music channels. I don't want any of the news or whatever. And, you know, Heather's like, yes, we do. I'm like, oh. So finally, I got, like, this really cheap deal of, like, $7 a month.
Yeah.
For a year. And so by the time I hung up, I was happy. It's like, okay, we don't have to pay for this for a year. And then we're paying $7 for a month for a year after that. For pissing me off, that's a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
And so the Sonic, you know, there's just, you know, I, to be honest with you, I rarely listen to it at all. I listen to podcasts, or I also have Amazon Unlimited Music because I have Amazon Prime. Uh-huh. And I'll have, you know, you can make, I learned how to make playlists or whatever myself, and I have my own music that I listen to. So I rarely, when we went on our road trip, that's probably the most we listen to Sirius. Occasionally I'll turn it to The Ticket Sports Radio, or I'll turn it to EW Radio up until where they annoy me, and then I change it. I don't know if you've heard this foghorn sound that bam, 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 that plays on commercials or whatever. Bam, bam, bam. It's like a foghorn. It's supposed to be funny. They play them at raves or whatever. Well, on EW Radio, that's the only drop they have. And they'll play that, and I'm like, change it. And I'm like, that's, as soon as they play that sound effect, I change it. And I'm like, get a new drop, man. I mean, can you imagine having a radio show with no drops? I couldn't imagine that. And I don't have any foghorns. I would never do that.
So anyway, I was just kind of concerned, just wondering if you were getting charged for something. And obviously it sounds like you have with the... the Sirius satellite, you know. And
yeah, I've, yeah, said, I've had, it's like they I'm, do I'm try to talk
the,
you out of it.
I'm assuming the previous owner is still getting billed for my sat, and I, like I said,
it's possible, or they, you never know, you might have a free trial. Did they give you any documentation of that?
I got it in the mail like 2 weeks later, this big thing about Sirius.
Do you have Sirius on your Xterra?
Not anymore.
Oh, okay. Because you could always roll it over into that. You can change. They, on the website, they have it set up where you can pretty easily do that.
I have no idea who was paying for the Xterra satellite radio either.
Let me ask you, OnStar, do you mess with that at all?
No.
Because we don't either. When we got the Equinox years ago in 2013. It might. I don't know. Our car has a Wi-Fi hotspot built
the,
in.
Unless it's on the little touchscreen.
Yeah, yeah. It's, our car,
normally they're on the rearview mirror.
The Equinox has a Wi-Fi hotspot built in through OnStar you could get. And I'm like, hey, that's pretty cool. I don't know when we'd ever use that, but I'm going to check it out, like, to see how much that is. And I was like, oh, God, no. You know, yeah. It's like ridiculous amount. It's like $50 a month. I'm like, hell no. If maybe my job was driving state to state or something... But we live in a city where we get cell coverage. There's no need to have a Wi-Fi hotspot in your car.
You can go to any Starbucks and get it for free.
Yeah, yeah. It's just like we're, the place where we drove and we stayed in a cabin with Heather's parents and our niece and Emma with one bathroom. When I walked in, I looked at my phone and it was like, oh, no signal.
Yeah.
But there was Wi-Fi. And I connected to it, and I'm like, oh, thank God. There's enough Wi-Fi signal where I could, you know, look at Twitter and, you know, whatever. But at first I was like, oh, no, please don't say I don't have internet. I'm sitting here at a cabin. What the hell else am I going to do?
Yeah, I'm like, going to make a piano.
Whitland piano? All right, Steven, should we get into some news of any kind?
I guess we've talked enough about cars.
That was fun. That was good stuff.
Oh, you're going to tell them the fact that I forgot I told you I bought that car?
Yeah, it was so funny. You sent me a picture of the car. Because I was like, what car did you get? And you were like, I'll tell you when it gets here. And you sent me a picture of, and you said it's the last of the V8 Interceptors, which I appreciated. I thought was hilarious. And then, like, just yesterday, I go, or was it a
last
week ago?
Last week or a week before.
I was like, Steven, how are you enjoying that Challenger? And what was your reaction like?
I didn't answer you. I was like, oh, it's fine. It's good. I'm like going to myself thinking, how the hell does he know I've got a Challenger? I don't remember telling
him. He didn't remember. How does he know that? It's like, you so, did tell me. You sent me a picture of it.
It's been 3 weeks, and I forgot that I told you I had it.
Well, Steven, I thought this is funny. I watched a trailer for a Netflix horror movie today, and there's something very familiar about this. It's called The Silence. The Silence is about creatures who will kill you if you make a sound. Wow, that's a great idea, reports IO9. Now listen to this. Last year, around this time, a movie about creatures that would kill you if you made a sound was released. This year, the exact same thing is happening. This year, though, the movie is called The Silence, and it's coming to Netflix this month. The film is based on a 1999 novel from Tim Leben, which means it predates last year's film, A Quiet Place, by some time. Plus, when you watch the trailer, you'll see that while that overall while the overall ideas are similar, this is a very different take on the material. Let me just show you this trailer real quick, Stephen. Okay. Gotta be
something's
very quiet.
Happening.
Something is happening. I hope something happens or it'd be a boring movie. Okay, Stanley Tucci. Love Big Night, by the way. Have you ever seen that?
What's that?
With Tony Shalhoub. Oh. Oh, my God.
Achoo!
Oh, she coughed. Shut up, you old bag! Oh, no.
Give her a lozenge, quick!
Cities across the eastern seaboard are coming under attack. The CDC is warning to stay in your homes and avoid contact with these creatures.
Hey, John Corder. It's like northern exposure hype right now.
I'm sure this is all going to be over soon. I promise.
Entire regions of the country are being
They look like some kind of bat creatures.
It's like we're back in the dark ages.
Be very quiet.
We're surviving.
Uh-oh.
Can't trust anyone now.
Creepy religious zealot guy.
No noise.
Listen, listen. Listen. Listen, listen.
Show Elmer Fuzzy. There we go. Who's this creepy guy? Okay, so these flying creatures will attack you if you make a sound. So it's kind of like A Quiet Place, only they fly. Here's what I would do. Flamethrower aimed at the sky, foghorn, and just set them all on fire.
Set your little alarm clock going off with a grenade right next to it.
Yeah.
Boom, you've killed a thousand.
And, you know, maybe in the
size.
Maybe in the movie they'll be like they're fireproof or they're bulletproof and make it even harder and harder.
Grenade proof.
How hard would it be to like? Okay, if there was creepy bats and stuff in this house, if they could break through the windows, we board it all up or something. I mean, it just seems like they could handle this pretty quickly if this happened.
Yeah.
Just like if some kind of zombie thing happened, it would never get Walking Dead because people would figure out how to kill them. I swear we would wrap it up by the end of the week or something. There would be no, the World War Z where they're super fast zombies, that's a little bit harder to deal with, but the slow lumbering like Walking Dead,
you can handle it. If they changed that fast like in World War Z.
But if you had this, slow zombies, fast zombies, and flying bat creatures all at the same time, then that's harder to deal with. And the Quiet Place also,
monsters.
Those all at the same time, then we're totally screwed, right?
Yes.
Because don't make any noise.
But the zombies, you tie bells to their neck and that creature's going to attack
them. Oh, smart! You got this lick, Steven!
It's like you make a little, the tripwire with bells on it, and the zombies stumble into it, fast or slow.
They should do that on the friggin' Walking Dead anyway. Just tie bells around all the zombies, that way they're all just bumping into each other all the time. That'd be genius!
See?
We are always smarter than that
wind
show.
Wind chimes on them or something. They're always...
Wind chimes?
They're dangling behind them, rattling on the ground. Ching, ching,
so. Always, God. You could always outthink that show so easily. But anyway, this article says, so unlike A Quiet Place, The Silence seems to tell more of the origin of this soundless world instead of a story from later in the timeline. The creatures don't seem to be supernatural. More likely, they're just kind of really messed up bats. Based on Netflix's description, Kiernan Shipka's character has some kind of mysterious power because she lost her hearing at an early age. So there are lots of differences between the films. I think they're being sarcastic there. Besides the fact that The Silence was written almost 20 years prior. But of course, the idea of a family which hear... You know, what's funny is the whole silence thing. You got to be quiet around zombies, too. If you make sounds, you hear them. But it's not an original idea. It's just how you do
just
it.
Just the execution of it.
And you know what's funny is, speaking of zombies, I saw this. Watch Dolph Lundgren lead a band of soldiers against an army of zombies.
Nice.
If the zombie apocalypse is upon you, there are a few better people to help you survive than Dolph Lundgren. And that's exactly what he'll do in this new movie, Dead Trigger. Opening in theaters on demand on May 3rd. Yeah, mostly on demand. Dead Trigger seems pretty straightforward. A virus has turned humanity into flesh-eating zombies, so an elite soldier played by Lundgren leads a team of badasses to kill them all. Because honestly, what more do you need than that? Watch the silly fun trailer below. All right, let's watch this, Steven.
Better be silly fun.
Dead Trigger, starring Dolph Lundgren. Music's back. Oh, here we go. When the dead rise up, one elite soldier will make them pay.
To kill the dead.
Wait, can I just say something? I love the boom. I gotta hear that again.
To kill the dead.
Yes.
Ground Zero was the first place the virus appeared.
He's got
Ground
like a
Zero
neckerchief
holds many
on
secrets
or
that could lead to a cure.
I kept thinking it was Bill Sapp.
Okay, rookies. Time to get your hands dirty.
Try to kill some zombies.
Remember,
I must break the zombies.
Shooting. We don't want to wake up this entire infested city.
Captain?
We got company.
Ooh, another one. Boom.
They're
from
everywhere.
The producers of Machete Kills. All fun, great. Killing lots of zombies. Wow, they're really going to play that sound over.
Show me what you can do.
LFE Rumble.
Dead Trigger.
To get a car, tie a big thing of wire across it, honk your horns, and you just drive through the town slicing them all in half.
Okay, there's another. I just thought of another. Yeah, that might work. There's another zombie trailer I want to show you, Steven. This is Black Summer.
You can save a whole lot of...
This is also coming on Netflix.
Yes.
Have you watched this?
Yes.
Let's see if they have a deep bass rumble.
Nice shings after
a dozen. I was just about to say that. Okay. In the trailer...
Picks a knife up off a table.
It's not just a knife. It looks like a butter knife.
Butter knife.
And you hear, shing. Like it's a friggin' katana. Shing. But it's a friggin' butter knife. We got to hear that
table,
again.
Off a table, not in a...
Okay, so people listening right now, this isn't a samurai sword. This person is picking up a butter knife.
Even if it's a steak knife off the table.
Yeah, listen to the
we'll
sound.
Look at it a little closer. It's a butter knife.
It's shing.
Full
it's like
on.
Friggin' Excalibur she just picked up. Shing. What's the Foley artist like, I gotta make the scene interesting, guys. You know, I know it's a butter knife.
This is gonna be hilarious.
I can't get over that. Shing. Netflix presents.
They don't know what the hell is going on.
Okay, I just want to ask you right now. Filmed in Canada?
They
filmed in Vancouver. Which is a beautiful place. That's fine.
I'm going to make a movie with you.
That's my daughter.
Black Summer, season one.
So, to get out of here.
Oh, did you hear that?
Make hard decisions.
Gotta do it again. Okay, listen.
Do you get out of here? We gotta make hard decisions.
Let me ask you this, Steven. Has this already aired in Canada on TV, probably?
Yes.
Zombies. These look more like rage zombies, don't they? These are rage infected.
Is there anywhere that's safe?
Toronto. We're ready for Saskatchewan.
Yeah, that's a rage. Crazy in that.
Yeah, it's definitely
rage zombie.
Black Summer. I'm gonna check it out though. I can't get over that butter knife, Steven.
Told you I need to have a pen on the table. You gotta pick it up to write a note. Shing.
I know.
Why does everything go shing?
I was just seeing what people commented on. Someone said prequel to Z Nation.
Yeah, I heard that the Z Nation was supposed to be kind of. I can't remember if it was. I thought it was Black Rain, not Black Summer. Black Summer.
Is this by the people who made Z Nation? Or is that person kidding? I couldn't tell.
There was supposed to be like a Black Rain or something.
Oh,
I can't
okay.
remember.
I just want to see if I look up Black Summer, like if it's the same people who did Z Nation. Because Z Nation got canceled, right? Creators, John Hyams, Carl Schaefer.
They did finish the story, and then the way they
yeah, look,
it was...
Yeah, look, producer of Z Nation. I think this producer of okay. Black Summer, producer of Z Nation.
So yeah, it was supposed to be kind of a continuation or a...
Because wasn't Z Nation kind of a comedy also?
Yeah, it was great. They handled the zombies fantastic.
This looks more serious.
Fantastically, but
this is just a trailer. But is it more serious? Do you think
that looked more serious? Because in the zombie one, in the Z Nation one, they had some silly ones. So it's like,
let's see, Carl Schaefer. He also
some big giant
writer on Z Nation.
There was a giant cluster of zombies that rolled. So, I mean, like hundreds of them, and they.
So look at this; it's the same writer as Z Nation, also. So yeah, so I think they're right.
Yeah, I was thinking Black Rain, maybe Black Summer. I guess you're right.
God, I love that butter knife. Oh my God, shing!
That sounds like a good. That would be fit real well into Z Nation.
Okay, Steven. I don't know if you saw this. Here's what's really going on with the Star Wars 9 poster that fans are freaking out about. Mark Hamill has stepped in to set the record straight. Okay, everyone was going nuts on Twitter about this poster. I looked at it for 2 seconds, and I could tell this isn't real. Like, maybe images of characters are real.
Somebody pieced it together.
Yeah.
A fan or something.
For the past few months, fans have been living in what one might call a drought of Star Wars-related news. A trailer is imminent, and by imminent, I mean... One will likely be released anytime between now and December 20th, but at this point, fans don't even know what the title of the movie is. There hasn't even been a single official image. So when a poster started going around Twitter that appeared to be the real deal, fans got pretty damn excited. A number of news outlets wrote about this supposed poster, then mysteriously deleted said articles. What was this poster, and why were these posts deleted? This was the poster in question. Okay, you could just look at it for a second. There's Rey. There's all the characters. Those look like the Knights of Ren. Yeah. It's not a very good picture, but it's a bad Photoshop job, right?
Yeah.
And even some guy tweeted it, new Star Wars Episode 9 posters leaked? Click on my article and you'll see. Notice C-3PO hilariously holding Chewbacca's bowcaster in the picture. I don't know if you noticed, like, right there. C-3PO is holding the bowcaster. There's also this effing thing behind Finn, this weird-looking alien. Anyway, fans kind of breezed over some of the weird parts of the poster in favor of what looks like the highly anticipated Knights of Ren on the bottom left side. Unfortunately, all the excitement was for nothing because Mark Hamill quickly chimed in on Twitter to debunk the fake poster. Dude. Looks like the work of a UPF. Okay. Doubtful, he said in response to a tweet. Looks like the work of a UPF. UPF in Hamill's Star Wars lingo stands for Ultra Passionate Fan. He reiterated it once again after another fan asked him if it was real. I'm pretty sure that it's just the wonderful work of a passionate fan, is what he said. Yes, you know all those ultra-passionate fans out there dying to see C-3PO jump into battle for the slug thing to do whatever the slug thing does. Just imagine what it will be like when some actual Star Wars news breaks. I'm still hoping the slug guy and War 3PO are real. This is from Esquire.com, this article. But I thought it was funny because, I mean, you're looking at it, you're like, oh, whoa, this is pretty... Wait, C-3PO's holding a bowcaster? What is that weird alien dude right there? I don't know.
Who's off his head.
Who's this chick? Who's this lady? Obviously, they got some images from Episode 9 from somewhere, and they, like, photoshopped it. They pieced it together to make a poster. Anyway, I thought that was kind of funny, because I saw it for a few seconds. Okay. Steven, are you a fan of Batman? A Batman lore? Do you watch Gotham?
Yes, I do watch Gotham.
You do watch Gotham? Okay. Uh-huh. Well, did you know there's going to be a Pennyworth series based on young Alfred? This is crazy because I thought Gotham was ridiculous because Batman's a little kid.
Yeah.
But now they're like, how about we go back further where Alfred, he was this badass agent. We got to watch this. Batman's Alfred is basically James Bond in this first teaser for Pennyworth. Okay, check this out.
My name's Alfred Pennyworth, by the way.
Pennyworth this summer.
We had another shing with the...
Yeah.
With the
shing! The Let's see that. That had probably a more realistic knife sound than the other two. Shing! Hey, Heather, you want me to butter this cinnamon toast? Sure. Shing! My God, how sharp is that blade? It's got to be sharp with this butter. It hasn't been, you know, it's been in the fridge for
if
a
you
year.
You pull that butter knife, you better cut some butter with it. Yeah. Isn't that the rule with the katana? You've got to have blood if you unsheathe it. If you unsheathe that butter knife, you better put some butter on something.
Well, Steven, here's the bad news. This series is for the Epix channel. I don't have Epix. Do you have Epix?
I have no clue.
I don't think Epix is in... even on DirecTV. This year marks the 80th anniversary of Batman's first appearance in comics, but perhaps most importantly, also marks the first time the Cape Crusader's butler, Alfred, received his own prequel television show. Pennyworth, which stars Jack Bannon of the Imitation Gang as a young version of Bruce Wayne's caretaker, will arrive to Epix this summer from Gotham's Bruno Heller and Danny Cannon. These are the same guys who do Gotham, by the way. A first look teaser shows off the tone of the series, which plays like a James Bond by the way of Captain America the First Avenger. Here's how DC describes the series in the footage premiere. Pennyworth blazes largely new ground and is not a spinoff or a prequel to Gotham, so don't look for familiar villains or allies in that brief sneak peek, with one exception. In Pennyworth, we get to know Alfred when he's 20-something former SAS officer who forms a security company and winds up working with a young Thomas Wayne in the 1960s. The series also stars recording artist Paloma Faith, Jason Fleming from the Curious Case of Benjamin Button, Ryan Fletcher from Outlander, Hainsley Lloyd Bennett from The EastEnders, Emma Pates from Gentleman Jack, and Polly Walker from The Mentalist. According to DC's own report, the series finds Alfred dealing with a malevolent secret society operating in London, which we catch glimpse of in the 15 seconds of footage. Alfred, first introduced in the pages of Batman as comic relief, morphed into a wiser form of Alan Napier's version of the character in the 60s television show. His backstory would later include a life lived as a former Shakespearean actor, an army medic, and a British spy. He passes on his expertise in disguise and throwing voices to a young Bruce Wayne, after inheriting the post of the Wayne family butler after the death of his father. Pennyworth, expected to run for 10 episodes, does not have an official debut date, but it will arrive after Gotham ends its 5-season run on April 25th.
Says it's on, like, Sling TV.
I think Epix, you might be able to...
It says it's on a satellite, too.
I think it's, like, it might be on Spectrum Cable and, like, Dish Network or something like that.
Oh, wait.
But I think that they have a a paid version, like an online streaming version.
Yes, there is an online version.
But if you're a fan of Gotham, you may dig it. If you're a big, especially if you're a big fan of Alfred. Is Gotham, I mean, I watched the first season and a half of Gotham. And I...
Oh, you could have gotten it through Netflix, but Netflix isn't renewing their deal with Epix.
Oh. Well, some things that aren't available on Netflix here will be available, like, in England or something like that. In Europe or whatever. So, okay, Steven, did you know that right now Kevin Smith is making a Jay and Silent Bob reboot?
Yes.
Actually, I think they just finished principal photography, and he's getting a lot of old cast members, Jason Lee, Joey Lauren Adams, Rosario Dawson. They're all going to have little cameos and stuff. But some people have been asking, what about Ben Affleck? He was a huge part of the Askewniverse. He was in Chasing Amy. Uh-huh. He was in Mallrats. He even had a cameo in Jay Silent Bob Strike Back. He played Holden, also Shannon Hamilton. And he used to be a good buddy of Kevin Smith till they had a falling out. And for the longest time, I didn't know why, but I finally read that the reason Ben stopped hanging out with Kevin is because Kevin jokingly said that I tell everybody everything. I can't keep a secret. And I like to I talk on podcasts about every experience I have, every conversation I have. And Ben Affleck, he's a very private guy. He's always in the tabloids. He's like, I can't deal with this. I can't tell you shit. I can't do things around you. So that's basically why he stopped hanging out with them. Because, you know, when he married...
He's not mad at him. He just doesn't want to be around him and exposing his business. Not secrets, but just business in general, you know.
So a lot of people were wondering, especially People Magazine, would Ben Affleck appear in the Jay and Silent Bob reboot? Ben Affleck is up for appearing in Jay and Silent Bob reboot, despite fallout with Kevin Smith, the article says. Ben Affleck is willing to put some beef aside to reboot a beloved movie franchise. Months after Kevin Smith opened up about his rumored fallout with his former BFF, Affleck discussed potentially collaborating with the writer-director on the Jay and Silent Bob reboot that's in the works. Asked if he was also in Clerks for a moment, the Clerks 2, remember?
Yeah.
He was standing there at the counter. Asked if the two beloved characters from other Smith films, Shannon and Mallrats, Shannon from Mallrats and Holden from Chasing Amy, would make an appearance in the reboot, Affleck told Collider, "Your guess is as good as mine. I haven't been asked to make an appearance, but you never know. There's still time. We'll see. I think if it's up to me, I'd rather do Holden than Shannon, but I would defer to Kevin." In November, a Twitter user asked Smith, 48, about the relationship, writing, "Sometimes I wonder what really happened between Ben Affleck and Kevin Smith that made them not talk to each other," tagging both stars' accounts. Smith responded, "If I had to guess, it's because one of us had a big mouth and told too many candid stories that sometimes weren't his to tell, and the other one is Ben." In 2017, Smith got Affleck into some hot water, claiming to a film festival audience that Affleck had said, "A man kissing another man is the greatest acting challenge an actor can ever face," while filming 1997's Chasing Amy. In the romantic comedy, Affleck kisses Jason Lee. Well, that's a typo right there. They said Jason Lewis.
Yeah.
Reacting to Affleck's widely reported comments, Evan Rachel Wood tweeted at the time, "Try getting raped in a scene. Also, grow up, Ben." She's got a point. Smith later reflected on the allegation, telling the Daily Beast, "Out of context, it's completely a different sentiment. It got him into trouble." Affleck, 46, has starred in 6 films directed by Smith, all of which were released over the course of it. Oh, yeah, I can't forget about Dogma.
Yeah.
Big names of the bunch include Mallrats, Chasing Amy, Dogma, Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back, Jersey Girl, Jesus, I forgot about that too,
yeah.
Clerks 2. Their last collaboration was in 2006. So anyway, Kevin Smith has been putting some behind the scenes things on YouTube, but I haven't heard anything about Ben Affleck
being there. And Randall won't be there either.
Yeah, something about he turned into a real...
No, he got issue with not being paid right for Clerks 2 or something.
Yeah, yeah,
It was a money issue.
Yeah, I've read a few things about that, and...
But his name's not Randall. What is it? It's
Jeff
Anderson.
Jeff Anderson. Smith confirmed his growing distance from Affleck after fans were urging him to direct The Batman, which Affleck had signed on at the time. I'm flattered, but three things make me directing Batman impossible, Smith wrote. Haven't spoken to Ben in years. I made yoga hosers and common sense. Anyway, they're just filling article here. And they have links to...
Yoga hosers?
No. Pretty bad?
It's silly, yeah.
All right, Steve, what do you say we do some Rotten Tomatoes here?
Sure.
I'm curious about a few things in this week, and let's do this thing or something.
Or something?
Steven?
Yes?
Let's read Rotten Tomatoes.
Okay, let's read them. I'm waiting for the music.
Steven, what do you say we read some Rotten Tomatoes?
You say either.
Why not?
I say
I shing.
Say neither. And I say neither. Either, neither. Let's call the whole thing off. Yes, you like potato. And I like potato. You like tomato. I like tomato. Potato, potato. Tomato, tomato. Let's call the whole thing off.
Smell like stale tomato juice.
That it does.
You're
supposed to swing your sword like this. You're swinging yours like this.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that.
You need to make a drop of the shing.
Shing? I know. I was looking to see if we had one. I don't think we do. All right, Steven. Dumbo came out today. Tim Burton's live-action Disney film. And right now it's got a 52% rotten on the old tomato meter. 224 reviews counted.
So that's average.
It's got an audience score of 62%. Liked it. I got to admit, it's a little bit low that I would have thought for just thinking about...
Is it a little too quirk Tim Burton-y for kids?
I wondered that. Here's the thing. I'm not sure I trust Tim Burton anymore. I'm not sure I've trusted him since Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. My favorite Tim Burton film for a long time has been Ed Wood.
Big Fish for me, obviously.
Yes. And has he... His last
you
couple of films
seen
I've
that
did.
One, though, have you?
Big Fish. I remember. I think I've seen it once. Maybe you haven't watched all of it because I don't have a strong memory of it. So anyway,
you should watch it.
Okay. Now let me
Maybe
read a
I'll
few
bring
of these
the
reviews.
DVD over for you to watch, sir.
A DVD? You don't
Blu-ray.
Have it on Blu-ray.
It's Blu-ray.
Okay. Peter Rayner
Calm
of the
down, sir.
DVD of the Christian Science Monitor says, "I was expecting a surplus of cute close-ups, but Burton does surprisingly little to win us over. He's never been big on treacle. What is this word? Trickle?
Treacle."
Treacle.
A thick, sticky, dark syrup made from refined sugar. Oh, I see. He's never been big on, like, sappiness. Is that what he's saying?
Okay.
But a bit more warm. Shut up. I'm not even going to read. Just for using that word, I'm not reading this. Okay, Adam Graham from Detroit News says, lost in all of this is Dumbo himself, a CGI creation with big ocean blue eyes and those lovably floppy ears, but the spirit and heart of the original Dumbo is still locked away in the Disney vault. C-. Okay. Chris Klimek of NPR says that the plot involves having DeVito's modest family-run circus being swallowed up by a mogul with his own theme park is almost too obvious a metaphor for the back half of Burton's 35-year career. Okay, do you understand what he's saying there? Kiko Martinez of the San Antonio Current says, director Tim Burton uses his gothic style to darken the mood, and screenwriter Aaron Kruger takes the narrative into unfamiliar places. But when the titular pachyderm is not front and center, Dumbo feels like it's gliding, not soaring. C. Okay, let's read a good review. Devesh Sharma of Filmfare says, you watch the film because the baby elephant, you don't know whether it's real or created by CGI, is really cute. And the sequences where he flies do have magical quality to them, 3 out of 5. Okay. Dustin Putman of the Film File says, this new Dumbo, while not without a few moments of whimsy, tries to overcomplicate the beautiful simplicity of the original. And what we're left with is not even a quarter of that classic's depth and wonder. 2 out of 4.
Average.
Average. John Louis of the Straits Times from Singapore says, the walking the line between reality and fantasy is hard, and the decision for Dumbo, the flying elephant, to feel like a miracle fails to pay off. 2 out of 5. So I'm starting to think that Dumbo isn't front and center in the movie. There's like, you know, because there's a lot of people in this, you know, stars in this. You know, they've got Danny DeVito, Michael Keaton, Colin Farrell. Do you think maybe he spends way too much time on the humans?
Probably.
In this,
it's like, it sounds like it's based around the family circus.
Yeah,
and Dumbo is what brings the circus back to life or something.
Yeah, makes him a success.
So it takes too long to get the elephant to bring it to success.
Here's one thing, and I think it's weird. Like, I've gone from loving Tim Burton back in the 80s to being really annoyed. Remember, I kind of have this huge hang-up about Edward Scissorhands when Anthony Michael Hall dies. And it turns into Frankenstein where the town villagers are chasing him or whatever. There's a little girl in this movie, if you've seen in the trailer.
Yeah, I have seen.
And she has a very Tim Burton-ish look to her. She almost looks like
Edward Scissorhands.
Helena Bonham Carter. Oh, okay. As a little girl. And as I watched the trailer and I saw that little girl's face, I was just like, oh, come on. Get over it, Tim Burton, with your little weird hang-ups and your... Oh, you know, like, she's an interesting looking little child. I got to have her in my movie. And I was just like annoyed immediately. Maybe that's my own hang up. But when I saw that little girl, it's not her fault. She's a child actress, right? But she's interesting looking. Of course, Tim Burton's going to have her in his movie. Freaking sicko. But I was like, screw you, Tim Burton. Just have a normal kid in your movie, not one that looks like Helena Bonham Carter, which he had a thing with for a while.
Yeah, he was.
That's
married.
Why I'm
they
saying he's a sicko, I think. Yeah. He's like, oh, this girl is my type. My type of female. He's a perv, Steven. Creeper! All right, so anyway, I've taken it too far. But anyway, Matt Brunson of Creative Loafing says, earmarked for disaster. Get it? Earmarked? 1.5 out of 4. Luke Parker, I'm on to something, though, aren't I? Robert Wool in Batman.
The elephant.
Funny
is,
or not funny?
In Batman.
Remember his character?
Yeah. It's okay.
Did you? There was somebody on Twitter recently. They go, does anybody ever talked about this? He goes up to the hood of his car and he bangs on it. It pops open. He takes out a baseball bat and it's like, have you ever seen anyone open their trunk like this in the history of filmmaking? And no one called attention to this. He goes, boom. And his trunk opens and he pulls out a bat. And they're like, I'm like, I can't get past this part of the movie. Like, why couldn't he have had keys? But they're like, no, just bang on it and it opens up. Yeah, he's the Fonz. Okay. Coupled with an uninvited human story at its forefront, Burton's chilling style makes Dumbo nearly unrecognizable. 4 out of 10.
So I'm going to do my little cute take.
That was Luke Parker.
The earmark for disaster.
Okay.
The elephant isn't the only Dumbo in Tim's film.
Mark Kermode, which my dad always like, hey, have you seen this? He like sends me the links, YouTube links to Mark Kermode. I don't know how to say his name. It didn't touch me emotionally. It's taken the fairy tale element out of it. Rotten. Okay. Randy McDonald. Dumbo seems to coast on its familiar fairy tale concept rather than fully taking flight. 2.5 out of 4. You know, they got to have flight, earmarked. They got to work.
This one says it coasts on the fairy tale. The other one said there was no fairy tale, too.
Well, Nick Johnston of Vanya Land says Dumbo isn't totally a return to form, but it feels like Burton's having a bit more fun than he did in the years past, and that fun bleeds through into the final product. That's fresh. Barry Paris of the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette says, director Tim Burton's live-action remake is considerably darker. Oh, it's dark. Ooh, that's a surprise. But true to the endearing and endearing, enduring original in its mini. Just for saying endearing and enduring right next to each other, he gets a fail for me. What do you think, Steven?
Yep.
Fail. Okay, Stephen Garrett of the Book and Film Globe says, it's not surprising that the actors give mostly robotic contributions. The kids in particular deliver line readings that are so nonplussed, they're virtually somnambulant. Sleepwalking. Just say sleepwalking!
Hey, come on.
Which was
Echo
worse?
Echo has a song called The Somnambulist.
Who does?
Echo and the Bunnymen.
Okay, so should that guy use it in his review?
No, he shouldn't use it in the song.
Which was worse, Steven, this or the guy saying that the movie had big on treacle?
Yeah, both are kind of equally terrible descriptions.
Oh, Ava Green's on this? In this? I changed my mind. I'm going to go see this. So anyway, that's...
That's Dumbo for you.
Yeah, it's Dumbo. Now, Steven, next Friday, April 5th, excuse me, Shazam comes out, but also Pet Sematary. Which are you going to see first?
I kind of would lean towards ding, Shazam.
Ding, ding. I'm leaning towards Shazam, too. You know, come on, it stars Zachary Levi. It's a comic book movie. I got to go see that. Right now, it's a 93% fresh.
I mean, I've seen obviously the first. I've read Pet Sematary.
Are you excited about this?
And I've seen the other movie.
Let's see. Right now, it's 87% fresh. Only 38 reviews counted.
And they've changed it up from the book. Everybody knows the friggin'. They gave away too much.
And the new trailer?
Well, talking about it, period. Everybody's like freaked out over the switch up that they do.
Go ahead and tell me. I don't know what it is with the switch up because I haven't watched the trailer.
Do you care?
Okay. do I care? I don't know. Like, I've seen the original.
We can do. It's.
Okay. In the original film. Because I believe it happens in the book, the little boy dies and he buries the boy in the pet cemetery and he comes back different.
Uh-huh.
Do they change that aspect in the new one?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So instead, the other child. I'm guessing the daughter instead.
Yes.
And that's what they change?
Yes.
Okay.
And they said it was just too dark for the young kid to do that. What they were going to do. So they made it the girl that was a little older that could handle the creepiness.
Oh, okay. Oh.
That was the excuse they gave. They're like, they figured she could probably give a better creepy performance than a small child give a creepy performance.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay. Does that bother you much? Or
I'll have to see the movie. I honestly, you know, it's like...
Do you remember...
And I can't try... You know, Stephen King's always like, hey, yeah, that's a good twist. Da, da, da. It's like, well, you also like the dark.
Yeah. Whenever Stephen King says shit about any of his movies that are being made based on his material, and he goes, I saw it. It's fantastic. It'll scare the hell out of you. I'm like, go F yourself, Stephen King. I do not trust you. First of all, you told me you were going to scare the hell out of me for Maximum Overdrive. You don't know what the hell you're talking about, buddy.
He was coked out of his head in Maximum Overdrive.
I do not trust him when it comes to this. I remember Alex and I used to laugh at this because when Pet Sematary was coming on cable.
I mean, I think he's a brilliant...
Writer, yes.
Not writer, but he pushes his movies. You know, he's like, oh, yeah, go see it. It's great.
Yeah. He's a cheerleader. He's going to support the studio.
Right.
He wants people to go see The Dark Tower. He's not going to shit on it.
Do you really believe he liked The Dark Tower? That's my only question.
I do not. He can't possibly. Unless...
And especially with all the stuff he says, like... Well, I never really described Roland. Bullshit.
Yeah, it's like, you're a liar, you know. Well,
described him to a friggin' T.
Well, here's another thing. Maybe he, you know, like, he's come out...
I never said Roland
vehemently. He can't stand Kubrick's version of The Shining.
Right.
He's come out, but that's like the one movie he couldn't stand. Now, why does he come out and he's truthful about that, but he can't say, like, oh, yeah, The Dark Tower's a... Piece of shit.
It's a turd.
Oh, God. It's a bucket of shit. avoid this movie like the plague.
It's like they put my all eight books into a bucket. They reached out and pulled out bits and then tried to mingle.
It is horrible. It's like, why bother? And by the way, I don't know if you saw that the
they're supposed to be doing
the Dark Tower TV series.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can find
Amazon?
That.
Amazon? Is that right?
Yeah, Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, here it is. Let me just read this for a second. This is good stuff. Amazon's Dark Tower series is actually happening, but with a new gunslinger. The maligned film adaptation isn't stopping Reboot from Blaine the Monoing forward. Okay, that was bad, Polygon. Jesus. Roland's destiny is to quest after the Dark Tower in perpetuity. So...
perpetuity.
That's what I said. So, two is Hollywood's...
perpetuity.
I said it right. I said
the other P.
Perpetuity.
Perpetuity.
Yeah, that's what I said.
You listened back to it
later. No. So, too is Hollywood. Stephen King's epic fantasy series is officially moving forward at Amazon under the eye of MRC, whoever the hell that is. Oh, I forgot to finish my story about when... there's a part in the... Pet Sematary, the film, was that the 90s? The Pet Sematary film?
Yeah, I think so.
Where Gage is hit by a truck.
Yeah.
And it's very tragic. But the scene, the dad, he goes, no! And they show, like, photograph of the little boy, birthday photo, being born, you know, he's in a diaper, and he's like, aah! And I remember Alex and I laughing. It's supposed to be a tragic scene,
yeah,
but we have tears in our eyes. We're laughing so hard at that. And I remember, like, he recorded it, and we would, like, occasionally play that scene over again and laugh our asses off. And I'm like, I always thought it was funny because it's supposed to be the most traumatic, upsetting scene in the film. And it's making us laugh our asses off because it's so over the top with his.
Fred Gwynn was the best thing of that movie.
Yeah. Herman Munster.
And,
which I'm sure he hates that everyone remembers him as Herman. He's like, I had a career before the Munsters, I had a career after the Munsters.
I was the judge in.
Yeah, the Two Utes.
The Two Utes.
And My Cousin Vinny.
My Cousin.
Despite a franchise-sinking box office return of $113 million worldwide on a $60 million budget, and negative reviews from every corner of the critical sphere, settling in the end with a 13% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. The only person that did like it was Stephen King. 2017's The Dark Tower didn't dissuade rights holders from forgetting the face of their father. Oh, God, just stop. The Stephen King boom is real, and the Dark Tower books would find life on the screen, even if it's a 40-inch one. And my TV's bigger than 40 inches, all right? Though a theoretical TV series version of King's books percolated after the disastrous film version, in January 2018, Amazon Studios head Jennifer Salke said that while she hadn't read any actual scripts for the Dark Tower series, the plan was very much alive. Okay, I'm already worried. There was little word of it when the project might spring to life or how long the company would have to wait to relaunch the property. The answer was not very long at all, according to Variety. Glenn Mazzara, head showrunner of The Walking Dead until he got fired, and then Damien, based on the movie series until it got canceled, is on board as showrunner with a pilot for the series in the process of casting up, making good on a rumor that the show could start filming as early as April. The report suggests that Idris Elba and Matthew McConaughey are out as Roland Sheen and Randall Flagg. Of course they're out. They were in a shitty movie. They're not coming back. Respectively, though, and it's a TV show. There were early rumors that the series would directly reap the A-list benefits of the film. Instead, with the series expected to adapt early stories from the universe, like those featured in the prequel novel Wizard in Glass, the casting skews younger. 25-year-old British actor Sam Strike, who was in the film Leatherface, which hey, I'm really jazzed about this, is reportedly playing Roland in the pilot, with Black Klansman actor Jasper Pakkinen co-starring as Flag. This is an aggressive play by Amazon, the land grab scramble for eyeballs. And the, okay, first of all, they should have done this in the first place, not made a movie. Okay, this is an aggressive play by Amazon in the land grab scramble for eyes in the wake of Game of Thrones' final season. Oh, shut up. Along with the Dark Tower, the streaming studio is also in the works on a Lord of the Rings series. And an update, and an adaptation of Robert Jordan's The Wheel of Time books. Amazon isn't thinking twice about the lingering effect of the Dark Tower movie, which after years and years and years of development, passing from J.J. Abrams to Ron Howard to Akiva Goldsman, sought to remix the mythology into a single digestible or undigestible feature film. That didn't work, but in today's blockbuster, a weak pace, no one will remember either. Though the loss of Elba is enormous for fans of the series.
No,
the
it's
new,
not a big loss.
It's fine. The new quartet means a future for the series that would carve out everything. I'm not.
No,
I
should have done. If we're going to do movies, you could do like a trilogy, do three books at a time, whatever.
I don't think enough people talked about how shitty this movie was. We did, and people, I don't think, saw it. Did it ever come on HBO or anything?
I have no clue, because I was not interested if it did.
I'm never interested in watching it again, I mean, but I wanted to hear more people shit on it. That would have been entertaining.
Shelve that thing and never let it see the light of day again.
I would listen to a weekly podcast of just people shitting on the movie every week. Do you remember that part?
The first 5 minutes. We're going to spend an hour destroying the first 5 minutes.
I just want to remind you of a scene in the movie. The man in black, played by Matthew McConaughey, levitating glass in the air, shooting it at Roland, and Roland holding his guns and going, pew, 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 deflecting it with his pistols. Do you remember that in the movie?
A la Wonder Woman.
What did you think of that scene in the movie, Steven?
Yeah, no.
No. No.
No. Why? What?
Oh.
Yeah, I don't remember Randall Flagg ever having that power.
Do you remember that scene in the trailer? And they also show the exact... Of course, the scene is in the movie, but Jake is being taken, and he's like, listening. Listening. Drop of water. Bloop. Brush up against a branch. And then he's like... shoots him just by hearing. Badass, right? No, not badass, stupid. Lame. Let's not forget about Rorschach checking Earl Haley's character in the movie. Oh my god, I'm so bad. So bad. Jesus. Okay, I want to talk about this. The new Twilight Zone is back, Steven. It's on the CBS app. Do you have the CBS app, Steven?
I do not have the CBS app.
Is it a freebie?
You gotta pay.
You gotta pay.
No, I won't have it.
You gotta pay. You can pay $5.99 with commercials a month, or you can do the free for a month deal, and then you decide to cancel it on that last day of the month. I've done that. I actually, I did that before because I wanted to watch
Star Trek one.
And one day I got the email that said, thank you. You know, your transaction has gone through of the first. I was like, damn it, I forgot to cancel it. I got charged for $5.99. I was like, oh, well, whatever. And I was like, damn, I got to cancel that. Another month goes by. Damn it. I got charged again. Damn it. I keep forgetting. That's what happens. They're counting on that.
I'm so tired of, you know, it's like, that's what satellite did. Brought all the channels together. You have a lump thing. Now I have to buy Hulu,
streaming, yeah.
This and that.
I will tell you this. Netflix has been pissing me off a lot lately with canceling series I love, but I keep it. You know, the Stranger Things trailer came out recently. That comes back on July 4th. Of course, I got to watch that. Hulu, I finally got the commercial free version.
Yeah.
Best thing I ever did. So much better not having to watch commercials. And I'll never get rid of Hulu and Netflix, most likely. The Disney streaming app, when friggin' The Mandalorian, the Star Wars series comes out, of course I gotta get it. I gotta watch that, right? So it's like, I'll probably cancel CBS at that point. But there's the DC streaming thing. They have a Doom Patrol show and a Teen Titans or whatever. I want to watch those.
I'm tired of being nickeled and dimed on everything.
Yeah. Well, I told Heather, I'm waiting for Doom Patrol to finish for the season and then get the free trial, and then we'll binge watch it and cancel it.
I need to look at canceling like all my my movie channels. Well, and I would get Netflix instead.
Well, it's say, okay, I think...
I mean, who cares? If I can watch all the same crap on Netflix that I could on satellite, but it's streaming whenever I wanted.
Well, there's two seasons of Star Trek now. What you could do is do the free trial for a month, binge watch both of those, cancel it. So you're not paying anything. But you just have to say, okay, I'm going to watch this now. Because that's what I did, but I didn't do it. I watched like the first episode, and I was like, oh, I'll get to it later. And then a month goes by, and I'm like, oh, shit. But anyway, I'm interested in The Twilight Zone, because I loved that show as a kid. You know, The Twilight Zone explores the strangest of the modern world through Rod Serling's winning formula, creating a thought-provoking, spine-tingling showcase for Jordan Peele and his exceptional crop of collaborators. Hopefully that didn't come through. It's starring Steven Yeun from The Walking Dead, Kumail Nanjiani, Adam Scott, and others. There are four episodes: The Comedian, Nightmare at 30,000 Feet, Replay, and A Traveler. Okay, let's see now.
Nightmare at 30,000, is that the...
That's like the...
Will Shatner.
Will Shatner and then John Lithgow in the movie. 84% fresh, 27 fresh, 5 run. Let's see what people say. Vern Gay of Newsday says, fine reboot that gets better in two later episodes. Brian Tallarico of RogerEbert.com says, reworking ideas from the original series in his own imitable style. Did I say that right, Stephen?
Inimitable.
Inimitable style. See, I said it that right the first time. Peele's riff on The Twilight Zone is mesmerizing and unforgettable.
Or speppity, whatever.
There's not much treacle in the series. Ben Travers says that it is an inclusive space as much as a creative one, making the 2019 Twilight Zone a new machine built to last. B+. Matthew Gilbert of the Boston Globe says, I'm looking forward to seeing more of Peele's Twilight Zone, even with its early mixed results. I came across enough satisfying moments to inspire more mining for gold. All right. Joelle Monique says, there's something magical about Peele's performance. There's a twinkle in his eye, a gentleness in his telling of these warning stories, and otherworldly knowledge perfect for the series. Dominic Patton says, it's the rawest, best version of the rebooted franchise. All right, let's skip down to these two bad reviews. Robert Rourke of the New York Post says, perhaps like Black Mirror on Netflix, true fans will find the best episode of The Twilight Zone and obsess about that until the next obsession takes over. For the time being, though, the message we're taking away is that there's only one Rod Serling. Ooh, burn! Darren Franich of Entertainment Weekly says, the first four episodes are all bad, a mess of sleepy conceits grasping towards topicality, with on-the-nose dialogue spoken by boring characters. A couple sharp performances can't triumph against nonstop plot contrivance. Wow, that's pretty scathing, isn't it? He said they're all bad. What a dick. Kurt Loder, remember that dude from MTV?
I do.
He said haunting in a way that Rod Serling himself would likely have applauded. So who do I trust? That last guy from Entertainment Weekly?
I trust Kurt Loder.
Kurt Loder, okay. John Anderson of the Wall Street Journal says, despite all the twists and turns, the journey feels like your boat across the River Styx has snagged itself on the carcass of a 59 Buick. Okay, is this guy pretentious?
Yes.
Yeah, he's pretentious. I'm not going to listen to him with that sentence he's got there. That guy can go to hell.
If you got the majority of it, people say it's good. You know,
yeah.
There's a few people that's got to
They're like,
poop on it.
Yeah. I want to read one Shazam review. I don't want any spoilers or anything like that. Not that I care much, but I'm going to go see it for Zachary Levi. He looks great. He looks like he was born to play the role of a kid who turns into a superhero, right?
Yeah.
Let's see. David Ehrlich of IndieWire says, this heartfelt origin story is more than the sum of its immense charm and Spielbergian attention to detail. Let's see if a Google Translator can no definition found for Spielbergian. A B+. That's pretty good.
You just one review. That's all you said. No more.
Oh, but wait, Chris Stuckman. I watch this guy's reviews on YouTube. He does these great video reviews. I didn't know he was on Rotten Tomatoes. And I've already watched his review of Shazam on YouTube. The film is knowingly self-aware of what it is. The overall movie we got is saved by the charismatic performances of Zachary Levi and Jack Dylan Grazer. I give it a B. Okay, that's all I'm going to read there, but I'm excited. I think it's going to be great. And you know, by the way, we've both seen Captain Marvel, right? Mm-hmm. We never got to talk about that. I enjoyed Captain Marvel.
Yes.
I thought it was a lot of fun. There's actually a funny story. The people behind us were very loud in the movie. And we go see films. We went and saw Captain Marvel in Dolby Cinema. Mm-hmm. Loud as hell. Like, Emma can say, hey, I'm going to the bathroom. And I'm like, I can't hear you. What are you saying? I could hear the people behind us. And I was like, Jesus, they're loud. Like, if I can hear them over Dolby Cinema. And at one point, some popcorn fell on my head. And I was like, are you effing kidding me? And I kind of like peeked over there. I couldn't see them that well. It's like the wall was too tall. And I was just annoyed. And after the movie, I was telling Heather how, like, I got popcorn on my head. Who are these assholes? And she goes, Jason, they're
special needs.
They're special needs children. And I was like, how do you know that? She goes, I saw them, and I saw at one point the person who's there escorting him said, put the phone away. You can't look at your phone during the movie. And they're like, okay, and they put it away. And I was like, oh, so they're just having a good time. She was like, yeah, they're having a great time. And I was like, I'm a dick.
Well, you weren't, because it could have been assholes back there.
I felt like an asshole, though.
You never know.
You never know. But when the popcorn hit me in the head, I was like, are you kidding me?
I would have lost it myself.
And I got pretty annoyed. And I thought of you at the Skull Island. Remember the little kid?
Yeah.
Damn it. A Kong. It's Kong coming. And you're just like. I was like, whoa, Steven, he's something bad's going to happen here. I got to get him out of here. Steven, no, come on. Hulk smash!
What did I say? I said something, and the guy and the kid changed places or something.
At one point, you're like, Jesus Christ. Oh, yeah. At one point, they were taking a selfie during the film, and you were like, you got to be effing kidding me. And I was like, boy, did we sit in the wrong spot. But these are assigned seats. That's another thing. The whole row was empty. But they're like, hey, let's sit next to this guy. If you're going to have a kid who's going to talk and be louder in the movie, don't sit near people.
And it was 11 o'clock at night, and this kid was like 6 years old.
Yeah, he should have been in bed. But sometimes that happens when you go to the movie. Somebody's loud, and they're having a good time. But I kind of want to see the movie again just because I was a little distracted.
And that phrase, my Jesus effing Christ. I was coming out of the airport, you know, and I'm coming out of the exit of security here at Love Field, and there's a girl in front of me, and I guess her crowd, the people are waiting for her, are right there at the exit, and they block the whole exit. Nobody, you know, and I'm trying to get around them, and I've got my headphones on. Don't realize how loud I say it, and I was like, Jesus effing Christ. And the guy was like,
Jesus Christ!
The guy was like, line up, dude.
He said that?
He was like, you're blocking the whole exit, and nobody can get out of this place. You're
blocking it. Christ!
I, you know, sometimes
go back 10 feet. Let everybody walk out.
Yeah,
you can hug them 10 feet further out. You don't have to hug them right in the fucking archway. I was so irritated. And you know, I've got my bag. I've got my headphones on. It was probably a long day.
Yeah, we all have those moments.
You get delayed flights, and I'm just like ready to get to my car. Jesus effing Christ. You know, and I did, it was under my breath like that, but it was loud enough for Andy.
Yeah, we all have those moments.
And he said something like, lighten up, or whatever it was.
Hey, lighten up, buddy.
Sorry, dude. Sorry, or whatever it was. But it was an older guy, too. So, I mean, he was probably in his mid-60s, and his 20-year-old, 17-year-old girls were welcoming the other young girl that was in front of me.
Yeah.
I was just like, look. I've been flying for 10 hours. I'm ready. You know, I've been on the road for 10 hours. I'm ready to get home.
Yeah. You're ready to get the hell out of there.
Jesus Christ, move it!
Seymour!
Nobody's here welcoming and hugging me.
Yeah.
I gotta drive my own self home.
But I just want to say about Captain Marvel is that Ben Mendelsohn was my favorite thing about the movie. Remember, he played the Skrull?
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was a good twist in there, and I thought he was great. He always plays a villain, but I thought he was great in that. I loved his character. I got to say one part about, I love the cat. The cat was good. That was good stuff. But there was that moment in there where he's doing the, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And I was like, Groot? It's kind of the same
kinda
beat.
Groot-y?
Kind of the same thing that Groot does in Guardians of the Galaxy. It almost felt like they're like, hey, let's have him do the Groot thing. Didn't it feel like that?
And now you think, now I think about it. Yeah, a little bit.
Remember
yeah.
he's like, he goes, and there are all the characters just sitting there watching it. It's exactly the same thing Groot does. They're just doing it again. And I was like, okay, yeah, that's amusing, but I've seen it before, you know. But I had a good time, and I can't wait for Endgame, Avengers Endgame.
Or the two creatures in Force Awakens, you know, they're on the on them catch, you know, it's got the big
attack. But it just especially reminded me of that part with Groot where it did that. And that's fine, but it just
it was hilarious how
Samuel Jackson sold all those scenes.
How he loses his eye. It's like, it's just a scratch. And then the guy's
he's just like, I love that part where he's like, keep that thing away from me. And they're like, what? It's a cat. And he's like, I don't know. What the hell's a cat? That's a flurkin or whatever. And the Coulson, he goes, is it true your eye was because of what are those other aliens called? There was the Skrulls, and there were the whatever they're called.
Yeah.
And he's like, something like that, because he didn't want to say a cat scratched him or whatever. But that was funny stuff. And I'm especially excited about Avengers Endgame. I have
all the other talk about the movie, you know, the heavy, I wouldn't say heavy feminine vibe of it. You know, it's like everybody was complaining a little bit about that. You know, it's like,
you mean
it was a little heavy handed.
The douche nozzles online, you mean?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the music, you know, it was like all female music from the 90s.
Okay. The only song that really got on my nerves was the No Doubt song. I was just like, just because it's
girl.
Just
that's what I'm saying. I mean,
that's a terrible song. Yeah. You know? And even Heather, she was like, that's the worst, because she's not a big No Doubt fan. No Doubt. But everything else was fine, but that was just kind of like, bad song choice.
It was just a little heavy-handed with just having there were two male bands.
I know it wouldn't have been in the 90s, but I would have picked, like, Barracuda or something.
I mean, you could have picked, you know, it could be... I don't. It doesn't have to be heavy handed. You know, it's like it just seemed to, you know, and they were saying that it was beating you over the head with it, but it didn't distract me from the movie.
That
was
the only song that distracted me. Because she's saying I'm just a girl, whatever.
Yeah,
I wouldn't have a problem with any other song, but I just have never liked No Doubt. I always thought they were terrible. Remember when No Doubt was on Dawson's Creek? They all go to a No Doubt concert. Do you remember that?
Vaguely, yeah.
That proves you're a lame band if you're on freaking Dawson's Creek. And I think Andy, she kind of like OD'd or something. Or was that when they were at a rave? I can't remember.
That was a rave.
I might be confusing it with 90210, but they went to a No Doubt concert on Dawson's Creek, Steven. And there's nothing worse than showing the actors from a show, your characters, watching a concert where they're just kind of bobbing their head. I'm like, this isn't interesting. Watching people watch a concert is not interesting to the viewer. Have one of them OD on drugs, please. That's more interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, how about Andy? He's like, yeah. Have her have a panic attack or something.
She's sipping somebody's drink that got laced with something.
Euphoria. No, wait. That's 90210 for Brandon.
Yeah. What's her name? Gave it to him.
Yes.
A chick with the short hair.
Oh, what was the band who did the song Vaseline? She had Vaseline. Oh, come on.
What? Weezer.
Because they were on, they performed at the Peach Pit After Dark on 90210. I'm really pissed I can't remember this band's name. Oh, God. It's going to kill me. But they show, I'm not kidding, the cast at Peach Pit After Dark watching the band and bobbing their heads to the song. Is that interesting, Steven? I did think Captain Marvel, the character, I really love. I don't know how powerful she is. The Flaming Lips. God damn it. The Flaming Lips, of course. I'm sure the people listening are like, Flaming Lips, dude. Flaming Lips. Dude, it's the Flaming Lips. And I'm just like, But I want to know how powerful Captain Marvel is. Like, how much power does she have? What my favorite moment was is when Jude Law is like, I want you to prove to me right now. Can you, you know, maybe you can beat me in hand to hand. And she just blasts him. She goes, I don't have to prove anything to you. I would have loved if she said, I don't have to prove shit to you, dude. And, but I love that whole opening scene where they're on like a tactical mission and they're sneaking in, going in as a team. I thought that stuff was badass. I love like all that's the sci-fi, the space stuff is really cool. I want to see more of that, you know? Oh, and that's another story. Like, can you believe James Gunn is now back to directing Guardians of the Galaxy 3? That's awesome, isn't it? I'm really happy about that. He's the best guy to direct it.
Yeah.
It's his baby. And so I'm super excited about that. And that's pretty much all I got, Steven.
Is it?
That's all you got? That's all I got. Okay. So what do you say we wrap this bad boy up?
Sure. Let's do that.
All right, Steven. Why don't you go over there and I'll meet you over there in a second.
Okay.
Thank you. Good night. Here all week. Try the veal. And scene.
Right, Stephen, why are you standing over here?
What?
Why are you over here?
I should be over there. Sorry.
I thought you were going to be over there. I have these new Bluetooth roaming mics. We can go wherever we want in the house.
Well, let me go to the can, and I'll talk to you from there.
I'd rather not. That's bad. Don't want to deal with that. Wait, what's that?
I hope you had a hell of a piss, Arnold.
Oh, come on, Arnold. You know, it's a good thing we don't know anybody who's named Arnold and they go to urinate around us because we would say that every time.
Yeah. Whoops.
Whoops. Well, everybody, thank you guys so much for listening to this exciting episode of Entertainment Landfill News. This is Entertainment Landfill News, episode 63, by the way. I want to thank you guys for sticking with us. Sorry for the long gap between episodes. And by the way, I'm going to get back to doing more podcasts because here's the thing. My wife has been working from home for over a year now. And she's going back to work away from the house. I will have more room to record and do stuff, which is great. I mean, I'm going to miss her being here, but I'll be able to work. Because there have been times, Stephen, where I can't make a sound because she's on like a conference call. She's on a conference call. And it's like a comedy of errors. Like when she's like, I'm on an important call right now. Please don't make any noise. And baby starts doing her reverse sneezing. And she like looks at me and I have to pick her up, run to the bedroom, shut the door. And I'm like, she has to go through it. Or I'll like be, I was watching a funny video. It was so funny. Like, I was watching a video on YouTube that was hilarious and it was cracking me up. And she was on this important call and I'm like going, and I have tears coming down, and I kind of look over there, and she's like, like beams, like these evil eyes, and I'm like, oh, I better turn this video off, like, 'cause And
I'll pause it and come back to this.
Yeah,
later.
I'll come back to this later. And I swear I did do that. And I go, I went to the garage and I closed the door and I was let out my cackle. And I was like, okay, I'm good. And I come and sit down and I'm like, okay, I'm good. I'm composed. And I hit play and I'm like, okay, I gotta get back. I go back to the garage again. And she's just like this, like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm sorry. It was funny. Oh, good times. Thank you, Jessica. She loved the live show. Thank you for listening live, by the way. And anybody, you guys, come listen to us live. We're here every Friday. They're like, bullshit.
We know, suckers.
We're here when we can, and I'll be doing more shows. I can't wait to do some more Chuck series companions. After Shazam is...
Not next Friday because of Shazam.
After Shazam is a huge hit, Steven, Zachary Levi, he has some clout. He's going to be bringing Chuck back, I bet. You know, it's going to happen, right? Okay, first of all, Psych came back for a TV movie, and now they're doing Psych TV movie 2. That's all I want from Chuck. Maybe once a year do a Chuck movie, and it could be on Netflix or whatever. Or that would be so much fun, you know? I know they're not going to come back full-time and do a whole new season or anything, even though that would be awesome, but that would be great. But anyway, thank you guys so much for listening, and I'm excited to do some more stuff, you know? And I can't...
Shows?
We'll give our thoughts on Shazam next.
Sure.
I don't know a lot about the... Here's the confusing thing about Shazam.
All I know is from the 70s TV show I used to watch as a kid.
And he was Captain Marvel. Do you remember that? Shazam is Captain Marvel.
Yeah.
And but there's a Captain Marvel for Marvel. By the way, I don't think that's a good name, Captain Marvel. It'd be like having Captain DC for DC, isn't it? It's like you're captain of the comic book company. I know that's not the origins, but yeah, I'm just saying it sounds kind of goofy.
She's going to take the name of Marvel.
Yeah, like the Marvel. I understood that, and I like how Dick Fury's that's like, Marvel. True. He's like, no, it's Marvel. He goes, Marvel sounds better, whatever. Yeah. They'll just call her Carol. It doesn't matter. They don't call Steve. You don't call him Captain America. They call him Steve in the movie, you know? Do you ever go, huh? When you're watching the movie and they go, Steve.
No, because I don't go by Steve.
Oh, okay.
You know that.
In the movie, if they go, Steven, would you go, huh, to the movie? Because that would be weird. Whenever I watch Friday the 13th movie, they're like, it's Jason. I'm like, huh? What? Somebody say something? They're like, no, Jason, it's the movie. And I'm like, oh, huh? I just don't pay attention
just
very
Jason
well.
In the movie, huh?
Who?
You seem easily distracted just by your name, sir.
I am. Whenever I hear somebody say my name, I'm like... Huh? What the hell am I even talking about?
The guy working with this week, he kept calling me Stefan. And because they spelled my name, uh-huh. Spelled my name wrong in an email. They spelled it with an A-N.
Stefan?
And I hadn't been paying attention all this time. And one of the guys... this
Jason, week, tell me.
What?
He keeps calling you Stefan. I'm like, he does? I would correct him if I heard it. So yesterday he called, you know, Stefan. I was like, it's Steven, sorry. And he goes, oh, okay, well, they spell it A-N. Well, yeah, they misspelled it. It's E-N. He goes, oh, I'm sorry. I was like, it's no big deal. You know, I was
scares
like,
scares me,
no.
Jason.
Huh? Stefan.
So hopefully I've corrected him now.
There are some Stevens. There's Steve, or there's Stevie, even.
No.
You've never had a desire to be Stevie.
No.
Hey, Steven, how's it going? Call me Stevie. It's like, Steven, how old are you? Why would you go? Do you have any nicknames by your family?
No.
Like, yo, Steve-O. They, no, nothing no. like that?
No.
Like, somebody might call me J-Bo?
No.
Or J-Bird?
Uh-uh.
Jace? There's no.
No, my buddy Dave will call me Steve-O.
Yo, Steve-O!
I get a Stefanski occasionally.
Stefanski?
Yeah.
That's a reach. What? How is Stefanski?
I don't know.
Nobody calls you Steve, but they'll call you Stefanski?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Steve-O, mostly. You know. So, yeah, I've got... That's all they would... Yeah, not too many nicknames.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody ever called me Steve, I would... I don't hear it, because I've never been called just Steve. It just sounds...
I'll fix this, Steve, and I can fix it. I can make it cool again.
Yeah, that's cool. Well, I'm going to call you Stevie from now on. How's that?
No.
Steven, shing! That butter knife! Oh my god, I love it.
I need a butter knife that makes that shing noise when I pick it up.
What a great story.
All right, well, guys, thank you guys so much for listening to the show. I can't wait to do another one, Steven. I can't talk.
Yeah. It's great.
Really good stuff.
Yes, it is. Really good stuff. I want to thank you, Steven, for coming here.
Thank you.
I'm like seeing your V8 Interceptor up front. It's cool. Last of the V8s. Piece of history. Would have been a shame to blow it up. And guys, I hope you're back with us soon. I've got nothing else. I want to binge Hannah, that show on Amazon based on the... I've never seen the film.
I've seen the film, I believe.
Is it good?
Yeah, I mean, it's fine.
It's okay. Yeah. It's fine. Hopefully the series is better. It's got Joel Kinnaman in it. Super sexy RoboCop. We watched that movie... what was that called? The Altered Carbon.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Did you ever watch that?
I tried.
He's...
We're watching it, and it's just like... I couldn't pay a close enough attention.
Yeah, you gotta just focus on it. Like, it's no distractions.
It's like, okay. And I went a long time between trying to start it up again, and I was like... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you gotta just start over. Yeah. Well, Joel Kinnaman is naked through a lot of it. And if you ask my wife, hey, what did you think of that? She's like, it's really good series. I'm like, oh, okay. And I was like, hey, Joel Kinnaman's in that movie, that show Hannah on Amazon. She's like, what? Let's watch it. And I'm like, oh, okay.
He probably won't be naked in it.
It's like, yeah, yeah. Well, he might take a shower. He might get real dirty and need to take a shower in one episode. I'm like, okay.
There's a young girl, but no.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It'd be creepy.
Yeah, unless, you know, he... Separate scene. She's on another part of the country. He just happens to be hot. And he, you know, he's been working on the car. He's all grimy. He's got to take a shower, you know? You got to show it because you got to know what he's doing. You're like, hey, where's this character? He's in the shower. Well, we got to see it, prove it. And then they show. He's sitting on the can. Oh, we don't want to see this. No, well, no. You guys wanted to see what he was doing. It's like, no, cut away, cut away.
Only if he's in the shower.
Okay, Steven. That's it.
Is that it for real this time?
Way to go, Steve. That's good stuff.
Yes, it is. All right, everybody. Thank you guys for listening to the show. We'll see you Oh, wait. What are you guys waiting for? Get out there, watch some new shows, and stream some stuff, and
watch some movies.
Twilight Zone, and watch some zombie movies with cool blade sounds. Oh, my God. That was so good. And we'll see you next time! Later, Steven!
Later!
Is that a katana or a butter knife? It's hard to tell.
Now this is podcasting!